Today we are going to talk about spondylosis. Spondylosis is spinal osteoarthritis. We have already covered osteoarthritis in the previous video. So we know that osteoarthritis is a degenerative condition, or it is a degenerative disease. Osteoarthritis of spine is called as spondylosis. So it can also be called as spinal osteoarthritis or osteoarthritic spine disease. Spondy means spine and losis means some trouble. Degenerative joint disease, it is a degenerative joint disease of exoskeleton, and it may affect the spine, the cervical spine or the thoracic spine or the lumbosacral region of spine. I will soon be covering anatomy video also for the spines and some other videos also. So in order to understand it properly, you have to go through all the videos. Above 40 years of age, the osteoarthritic changes in the spine starts happening in almost all of the people, but only few of them who have some risk factors, who are exposed to some risk factors or some other precipitating factors like trauma or incorrect posture or some job habits. These precipitating factors leads to some acute symptoms because of these osteoarthritic changes in the spine. Cervical region and the lumbar region, they are most affected, because cervical region, the neck has a greater movement, whereas the lumbar region is prone to get the maximum body weight, and it results in low back pain. Cervical region osteoarthritis leads to cervical pain, the neck pain, whereas the lumbar region pain, the lumbar spine osteoarthritis, leads to lumbar region pain or low back pain. So these degenerative processes in spinal osteoarthritis affects the vertebral bodies, the vertebras, the intervertebral discs, the neural foramina. The neural foraminas are the apertures from where the nerves comes out of the spine. The facet joints, the zygapophysial joints, Z joints, facet joints are Z joints. Right? So when the space between two adjacent vertebras narrows, then it results to abnormal growth of the bone. Those are called as bony spurs, and these bony spurs are osteophytes on the vertebral bodies. And these osteophytes, because they compress the nerve root which is coming out from the neural foramina, and it results in radiculopathies. We will try to understand this radiculopathy in later slides also, and we will understand this radiculopathy in radiological classes also. Now this radiculopathy, which is because of the compression of the nerve roots, or you can say impingement of the nerve roots, it leads to severe pain in the neck, shoulder, radiating to arm, back or leg. If the radiculopathy is in lumbar region, it leads to radiating pain in the back or leg, for example sciatica, muscle weakness, motor disturbances, right? Whereas if the degenerative changes, they are leading to direct pressure on the spinal cord which is running in the vertebral canal, in the vertebra, if that is directly pressurized, it leads to myelopathies. So myelopathies are a sort of disorders which are characterized by global weakness. That means below the point where the compression of the spinal cord has happened, there will be weakness. For example, let us say weakness of the legs, if the myelopathy is happening at the lumbar region. Gait dysfunction, the person will not be able to walk properly, loss of balance, loss of bowel and bladder control. So what are the risk factors for spondylosis in general? First is aging, because it is an age-related disorder. It is a degenerative disorder. So aging. Second is repetitive strain injuries, RSIs, because of some lifestyle, for example, somebody is working on computers for long hours, somebody is a driver, or somebody is even a laborer, right? Or somebody is a typer, right? Like that. So genetics, some of the genes, they are also held responsible for developing these degenerative conditions, especially in early ages when they should not happen. Smoking, occupational jobs like sports, right? Sports also leads to degenerative conditions, as we have already talked, that the cricketers, they leads to the osteoarthritis. They mostly leads to the osteoarthritis of the shoulder, right? Other people like athletes, they leads to the osteoarthritis of the knee. So mental health issues, depression, anxiety, especially obesity, they leads to these degenerative conditions of the spine. Injuries, trauma, accidents, right? The ligament tear or the muscle tear or direct breakage of vertebrae, they also leads to the early degenerative conditions of the spine. So let us talk about the cervical spondylosis, because cervical spine and the lumbar spine, lumbosacral spine, they are most at the risk. So let us talk about the cervical spondylosis first. So we know there are 7 cervical vertebrae. You can see it here. We will talk about them more in the physiological classes. So you can see this, the second vertebra, the C2, this is C1, this is C2, and this is C3. The C2 is sitting over the C3, and between C2 and C3 there is intervertebral disc, right? So C2 and C3, intervertebral disc, and at the back we have a spinous process, and to the lateral side we have transverse processes more pronounced here, right? And these vertebrae, they are also having another joint which is called as facet joint. So you can see this joint here, the blue structure here, is a facet joint, also called as zygapophysial joints or the Z joint. Now we know that joints are of two types. One is the solid joint and another is the synovial joint, which is filled with synovial fluid. So this Z joint is the synovial joint, whereas this disc which is joining the two vertebral bodies is a solid joint, which is fibromembranous in nature. And here the red structures, you can see that the size of the disc has narrowed as compared to here. The disc has narrowed, the smooth structure of the vertebral bodies has become this zigzag, which is called spurring of the vertebra, and the straight margin of the anterior side of the vertebra, right, has become a thorn like structure. It has protruded out. So that is the formation of osteophytes. We've already talked about this osteophytes and other things in previous videos. So cervical spondylosis is a chronic degeneration of the bones, we are talking about vertebrae here, of neck. And also this cervical spondylosis is the degeneration of the discs, the intervertebral discs, or the joints of the intervertebral bodies. It is called cervical osteoarthritis. It is more common in men and women who are older than 40 years, and it progresses with age. Men usually develop it at an earlier age than women. The degeneration in the cervical spondylosis is because of the wear and tear of the normal aging process, and it is accompanied with the development of bony spurs of the spine, which leads to the pressure on the spinal nerves and sometimes the spinal cord itself. So you can see here, you can see the spines, the yellow color are the spinal roots which are coming out. The spinal nerve roots which are coming out from the spine are the spinal roots, and these are coming from a space in between the two vertebrae, and that is called as neural foramen or intervertebral foramen, from where these roots are coming. So now if the vertebrae, they are having degenerative changes, then they encroach this space, they go into this space, the osteophytes, they go into this space, right, and they compresses the outgoing nerve root, leading to radiculopathic pain. Sometime if this degenerative process is too much, it starts compressing the spinal cord itself, which is running in between these vertebrae. There is vertebral canal, and in between that the spine is running, right? so if the degeneration is too much, it starts compressing the cervical the spine itself, the spinal cord itself, which leads to myelopathic processes, which leads to myelopathic disorders, right? So these spinal nerves, if they are compressed, it is called as radiculopathies, and if spinal cord itself is compressed, then it is called as myelopathies. So cervical spondylosis is basically a syndrome. It accompanies many disorders. So the disorders which can be categorized in cervical spondylosis syndrome are, number one, cervical spondylotic radiculopathies, CSR, the radiculopathies because of the spondylosis. Second is cervical spondylotic myelopathies, the myelopathies because of the cervical spondylosis, CSM. And third is vertebral artery type of cervical spondylopathy, which is also called as vertebrobacillar insufficiency. Because if you remember, we have talked about the vertebral artery in stroke classes. So the vertebral artery is running through these processes into the brain through this vertebras. The vertebral artery is running and vertebral artery is becoming bacillar artery. So it leads to, if there are osteophytic growth, that leads to the impingement or the encroachment of the vertebral artery also. Vertebral artery is also compressed and that leads to vertebrobacillar insufficiencies. So the pathology generally begins at the intervertebral disc, and when the pathology is starting from the intervertebral disc, then we call this as we study this in a separate group of diseases, which is degenerative disc diseases, DDD, degenerative disc diseases. So I have not covered this intervertebral disc degeneration here because I want to make another video for it. It is a very important disease. However, we will be studying this little bit here also. So degeneration of the disc because of the aging process, it leads to the reduction in the disc space. When the disc space is reduced, you can see it here. When the disc space is reduced, it leads to the rubbing of the bone. The cervical bodies, the cervical bones, they rub over each other, and when they rub over each other, we know they start producing the osteophytes. Osteophytes basically is a physiological way to maintain the gap between these cervical bones, because if there is no gap between the cervical bones, then it will lead to the restriction of range in motion. The motion of the neck will be restricted if there is no gap between these two bones. So in order to maintain that, physiologically the bone starts developing, the bone growth starts developing, resulting in bone remodeling, resulting in osteophytes. So osteophyte formation starts taking place because of the degeneration of the disc and reduction in disc space. These osteophytes, they impinge on the nerve roots which are exiting from the neural foramina or the intervertebral foramina, which leads to the radiculopathies, which gives a particular characteristic radicular pain in the upper limb. This radicular pain is having a characteristic of radiation from the neck to the arms, to the bilateral arms or to one arm. Exceptionally, these osteophytes, they may even compress the spinal cord itself, and which leads to the myelopathy. Spinal cord compression leads to the myelopathy, which has separate set of symptoms like weakness of the muscles, or the bowel and bladder dysfunction, or abnormalities in the gait, like that, which is a very major disease. Cervical spondylosis occurs most commonly in the lowest three cervical intervertebral joints, that is C4, C5, C5, C6 and C6, C7, most common at C5, C6, because that is the point which is most, which is having maximum stress. So sign and symptoms, pain and stiffness. Spondylosis results in pain and stiffness. If it is cervical region, it leads to neck pain and stiffness. If it is lumbar region, it leads to low back pain and stiffness, which gets progressively worse. It increases with time. The pain ranges from mild to severe and debilitating. Initially, the pain will be mild, ultimately it will go into severe, and ultimately it will be that much that the person will not be able to do any work. It will be debilitating. It will make the person handicapped. The condition may last for several months before they improve for a while, or sometimes they even become chronic and the pain stays there for a very long time, until some intervention is done. Neck pain might radiate to the shoulder and arms. That is, radiculopathic pain has this characteristic numbness or weakness in the arms, hands, fingers, which is because of the nerve root compression, because the nerves, they supply to the region of the skin and the muscles, right? Skin myotomic distribution or the dermatomic distribution. So these nerve roots, when they are compressed, it leads to the numbness, paresthesia in the arm, hands and fingers with neck pain. Headache is very common in cervical pain. In fact, it is the first reason the patient approaches the doctor. Headache that radiates to the back and the head. Muscle spasms of the neck and shoulder, very common in cervical spondylosis. Difficulty rotating head in all direction. All the cervical spine movements will be affected. Loss of balance, numbness or weakness in the legs, loss of bladder or bowel control. This is because of the spinal cord compression in extreme cases, which is called as cervical spondylotic myelopathy, CSM. Vertigo is another sign and symptom which patient tells. On especially on the rotation of hand, the person feels vertigo. Sign and symptoms continued. Loss of normal cervical lordosis. So cervical spine is having a normal lordosis. It is protruded towards the back, whereas the loss of normal cervical movements, loss of cervical range of motion, ROM, range of motion, that is flexion, extension, right, left bending, right bending, left bending, rotation. So tenderness, all these range of motions will be hampered. Tenderness over the lower cervical spine or the muscles of the paravertebral region, that means the muscles at the cervical region of the neck, they will be tender and there will be pain in them. Right, cervical radiculopathy, for example, if C4, C5 nerve roots, they are impinged, they are compressed, it will lead to the sensory and motor deficiencies of deltoid and shoulder region, and pain will be there in lateral arm, medial scapula and so on. The incidence of C6, C7 is maximum. The impingement of the C6, C7 nerve roots are maximum. So cervical radiculopathies, when the nerve roots, they are impinged, when the nerve roots exiting the vertebras, they are compressed because of the osteophytes. And myelopathy, when the spinal cord itself is compressed because of the osteophytes, or sometimes because of the disc which herniates backwards. The disc moves little backwards, or the disc protrudes backwards and compresses the spinal cord, which leads to some major symptoms like loss of bowel and bladder, gait abnormalities, muscle weakness, tingling sensations in the legs. So diagnosis is made by various physical examination and radiological examination. Physical examination like Lehermitte sign, Hoffman sign and Sperling test. We will talk about this in practical classes. And Sperling test is very common. In the Sperling test, we apply pressure over the head of the patient and we do the range of motions of the cervical region, for example lateral bending or forward bending or backward bending, like that. And if the patient complains of increased pain by these range of motions, then the Sperling test is positive, and by physical examination, we diagnose the person to be suffering with cervical spondylosis. Radiological examination, we will talk about this in detail in radiology classes. So the vertebras, these are two vertebras. This is the intervertebral disc, the solid joint, and between these two vertebras, there are Z joint or the facet joints. between the articular processes, the superior articular processes and the inferior articular processes, they join to form the Z joint or the facet joint. So this facet joint is also affected because this the articular cartilage thinning happens here because of the aging process, and the disc also becomes thin and degenerated because of the aging, which leads to the formation of osteophytes here, which leads to the impingement of the neural foramina. This neural foramina also becomes encroached by the formation of osteophytes, because osteophytes starts developing to all sides. So the exiting nerve roots also starts getting compressed, and accordingly the pain starts appearing. So you can see in X-ray these spurs of the bones, which are osteophytes, can be seen in the X-ray. The narrowing of the disc, see here the disc is healthy, it is wider in shape, in size, whereas here it is narrower. So the narrowing of the disc has happened. For myelopathies, for determining the size of the vertebral canal and the spinal cord, we do CT scans and MRIs, because X-rays don't allow us to see in sagittal planes. Lumbar spondylosis, let us talk about lumbar spondylosis. So we know we have 5 lumbar vertebras, L1, L2, L3, L4, L5, and similarly we have fused 4 sacral vertebras. So these vertebras, the lumbar vertebras, they are again separated by disc, or they are joined by disc, and this is the facet joint. You can see it here, facet joint here, right, the Z joint between the two vertebras. The articular processes, they meet and forms the facet joint, which is a synovial joint, whereas this disc is the solid joint between two vertebral bodies. So when degeneration happens, the disc becomes degenerative. As a result, osteophytes develop, and these osteophytes also do the nerve impingement, causing radiculopathic pain. Sometimes these osteophytes even compresses the spinal cord, which is running in the vertebral canal. So that causes myelopathy. So pathology is more or less the same. So degenerative disorder of the lumbar spine is characterized clinically by an insidious means slow onset of pain and stiffness, right, and radiologically by osteophyte formation. So clinically by onset of gradual pain and stiffness, and radiologically by osteophyte formation. If these two phenomena are there, we label the person as lumbar spondylosis. Bad posture, chronic back strain is the commonest cause. Other causes and the risk factors remains the same. Lumbar spondylosis may be applied non-specifically to all degenerative conditions, right? All degenerative conditions of the spine. For example, the discs are degenerated, or the vertebral bodies, they degenerate because of the formation of osteophytes, or other joints like facet joints, they degenerate. So area of maximum mobility and stress is L4-L5. So L4-L5 and L5-S1 are more common sites. L4-L5 is much more common. So this lumbar spondylosis is also called as lumbar osteoarthritis, disc degeneration disease, degenerative disc disease, or spondylosis, or many other spondylosis, deformans, like that. So what is the pathology? So we know that two major structures in the joint, they undergo degeneration. Number one is facet joints, and number two is intervertebral discs. So primarily degeneration begins in intervertebral joints and intervertebral disc. So it leads to the reduction in disc space and osteophyte formation. The degenerative changes in the facet joints also leads to the intervertebral foramen encroachment, which leads to the nerve root canal impingement, right, and which interferes with the proper functioning of the nerve, leading to paresthesia, pain, especially the radiating pain. So facet joints, these are synovial joints, so synovitis starts happening in them because of the degeneration. Synovitis and hypomobility, the facet joints will move less, resulting in lesser range of motions in the facet joint. It leads to the dysfunction of them. So this is the first stage, dysfunction. Also the intervertebral disc, they start degenerating. There are tears, circumferential tear at the circumference of these intervertebral disc. They are rounded structures. So it leads to the dysfunction of these intervertebral disc. Now these intervertebral disc and facet joints, they are responsible for the motion of the spine, that is forward bending, when we bend forward or we when bend backwards, that is because of these discs and facet joints. So both of these, they are affected. It leads to the dysfunction. The facet joints, they continue to degenerate, whereas intervertebral disc, they also start developing some radial tears, right? Circumferential tears are with the circumference, and radial tears are from the radius. So it leads to disc herniation. The disc starts protruding out, or the jelly-like substance inside the disc, at the center of the disc, it starts protruding outwards because the outer ring, that is annulus fibrosus, is having some tears. So it leads to disc herniation. So disc herniation and facet joint degeneration leads to instability. Now the capsular laxity, that is laxity of facet joints, because of degeneration of the joints, the facet joints will start moving away from each other. They will not be tightly held, so it leads to the laxity of the facet joint. It leads to further instability, and the IV disc tears, herniation, disruption leads to further instability. So this is the second stage after dysfunction, instability. Now facet joints, when they become subluxation, that is they are not properly held and they move more than the usual, it leads to, and the osteophyte formation also starts developing, it leads to the formation of the nerve entrapment or nerve impingement or nerve compression, one and the same thing, right? And the disc resorption or the disc thinning also leads to this nerve entrapment, because nerve is now having less space to exit, so it becomes entrapped. So development of osteophytes starts in region of the IV disc and facet joint both. It may lead to stenosis, that is myelopathic changes, and it may lead to both spondylosis and stenosis. Stenosis is the thinning or the narrowing of the spinal canal. The myelopathy develops in stenosis conditions, right? So this is how the pathology takes place. So there are three stages. First is dysfunction, second is instability, and third one is stability, or third one is because the body tries to overcome this situation by development of osteophytes. So this is, you can say, stable stage. So third is stable stage. So clinical features: low back pain, worse during activities, right? Initially it is present only during activities, but later it is present all over the time, right? The person tells that I have a feeling of a catch means whenever I get up from the sitting position, I develop certain pain and then it goes. Pain may radiate down the limb up to the calf, right, which is typical of sciatica, which is because of the nerve impingement of the sciatic nerve. Sciatic nerve originates from L3, L4, L5, right? So if the impingement of the sciatic nerves takes place, we get a syndrome called as sciatica syndrome, which has a characteristic pain which radiates from the hip region down to the limb and sometime up to the feet also. The transient numbness, paresthesia in the dermatome of the nerve root supplies to the skin in a dermatomal fashion. So dermatomes may have paresthesia, numbness, or it may have muscle pain also if the nerve root in the myotome is affected. Commonly on the lateral side of the leg or foot is very common on the lateral side, because this sciatic nerve is the major nerve which is going into the leg, so it is mostly affected. Diagnosis by physical examination is by an straight leg raising test, SLRT, very important test, SLRT. So patient in supine position, the therapist lifts the patient's symptomatic leg. You can see here the therapist, the doctor is lifting the patient's affected leg by himself, not by the patient. The doctor is lifting his leg and trying to find the pain. The person will not be having pain at the supine position when the leg is at 0 degree, but as soon as the doctor raises the leg, the person will start having some pain, and based on the degrees we will identify the pain to be of spondylosis or some other cause. For example, if the pain starts between 30 to 70 degree of the raised leg, then it is a positive test. The test becomes positive, SLRT becomes positive for lumbar disc herniation. That means lumbar disc disease at the L4, L5 and L5S1 nerve roots. Right, and it is much more specific if the ankle is dorsiflexed, that is Braggart sign, it increases the pain. So what the doctor do is dorsiflex. He folds the foot with his hand towards inside, dorsiflexion of the foot. So dorsiflexion of the foot at the degree where the person is having pain will lead to increased pain. So that this is again a confirmatory sign for SLRT. Right, if the pain is at less than 30 degrees, it is not because of spondylosis, it is because of another condition called as spondylolisthesis, which is slipping of one vertebra over the other because of, let us say, some trauma or some other like gluteal abscess or disc protrusions or some other tumors or some other conditions. And also if the pain starts above 70 degrees, then it is mostly because of the muscle spasms in hamstrings or gluteus maximus or some sacroiliac joint pathologies. Right, there is another test, cross leg straight leg raising test. We will talk about these in practical classes practically. So diagnosis by radiological examination. So we take an anterior posterior view and lateral view of the lumbosacral spine similar to that of cervical spine, especially after giving a mild laxative so that the intestines, they are clear and the x-rays are not blocked by the material present in the intestines, fecal matter in the intestines. Reduction, we see in an x-ray, we see reduction in disc space, we see osteophyte formation, we see narrowing of joint space in facet joints and also the narrowing of joint space in the vertebral bodies, that is reduction in disc space, subluxation of one vertebra over the another, which is also called as spondylolisthesis. Spondylolisthesis also happens because of extreme spondylosis. So you can see here the spine is not straight, it is bent, so lumbar scoliosis. And you can see the osteophytes here, these bodies, vertebral bodies, are generally straight, they are like square, mostly square, but here they are protruding outwards. So these spine like structures, the spinous structures, or these pricking structures are the osteophytes. And the disc space here has reduced, the disc space is normal, is like this, here it is reduced, right? And you can see osteophyte here and disc space reduced here, right? So what is the summary? Spondylosis is a degenerative condition of spine commonly seen in cervical and lumbosacral region. So this degenerative condition of spine affects vertebral bodies, the intervertebral discs, the facet joints, and eventually the spinal canal also. The spinal canal also becomes narrowed. It results in pain and stiffness. The hallmark sign and symptoms are pain and stiffness of the neck region or the lower back region. Worsens with age. So the changes in disc, the decreased elasticity of the annulus fibrosis. Now the disc is made up of two structures. One is annulus fibrosis and another one inside is nucleus pulposus. Nucleus pulposus is a jelly-like structure, whereas annulus fibrosis is a fibrous structure. So elasticity of the annulus fibrosus decreases and it results in nucleus pulposus protruding out, loss of fluid in nucleus pulposus, and also the nucleus pulposus pushes out of the annulus fibrosus. It leads to the decrease in disc height. The disc height becomes less. The osteophyte starts appearing in the anterior side of the vertebra also and in the posterior side of the vertebra. So in posterior side of the vertebra, these osteophytes, they start encroaching the neural foramina, the space from where the nerve roots exit the spinal cord. So this encroachment of the nerves or the nerve compression leads to radiculopathic pain. Facet joints, so you see here the facet joint between two vertebras, the facet joint between two articular processes of the vertebras. This facet joint becomes inflamed and development of osteophytes in them starts appearing. Right, so the facet joints leads to the hypomobility, right? The mobility of the spine becomes less. and formation of osteophytes in them. Vertebral bodies, the vertebral bodies, the development of sclerosis, see here, these osteophytes starts developing, and below the osteophytes, the bone becomes hardened. There is more deposition of bone here, and it leads to sclerosis. Intervertebral foramen becomes encroached, and spinous process becomes there is false joint formation. The spinous process, which has some gap, see these two spinous processes of these vertebrae, they have some gap, so ultimately this gap is reduced, so they form a false joint, and it leads to further decreased range of motion of the spine. So that's it. Thank you.